Most recently, we, some of us would have noted that there was a very public spat between two of India's best known, internationally best known economists. One of them won the Nobel Prize, one of them believes he should have won it and hasn't won it yet. And it led to a particularly, you know, almost like one of those Hollywood, Bollywood kind of very public, personalized battles unfolding. But there was an interesting undercurrent of highlighting what this debate is about. And it shows that this debate is still alive and unresolved. But I think you need to know clearly what the two positions were. Amartya Sen would say, to battle poverty, you must have, both of them say that they're not against markets. It's within a market framework. Both of them are functioning within a market framework. But Amartya Sen would say, and I would say, and many of us would say, that growth by itself has demonstrated, we have enough evidence now that growth in itself does very little to deal with poverty, because poverty is far more complex, it has social aspects, it has various others. And so you have to battle poverty, there must be a massive attack primarily on illiteracy and health. So education and health expenditures are very critical. These would produce a healthier, more productive, more literate workforce. All of these would yield greater revenues because this would spur growth, and a virtuous cycle would be set in motion. So basically, here we are saying, in a market economy, one view is that the state must invest substantially on health and health, nutrition, really, education, particularly school education. And these would in themselves spur further growth and achieve better. But but what Jagdish Bhagwati, Arvind Panikran have been saying, and in this very public way, is they're saying that no, we need what they call track one reforms, besides what I spoke about. We should facilitate liberalization of foreign trade and investment to facilitate the entry of private sectors in infrastructure, and this would hasten growth. They would not like the state to be seeing its primary role or major role in investing directly in health and education. They would like the state to play a role of liberalizing the economy further, hastening private investment, hastening growth. Rapid growth, this belief is that citizens would have, once you have more rapid growth, let health and education be in the marketplace, as I said. Let private players provide health and education. The state doesn't have to bother. Economic growth will happen, people will have get more wealth, more jobs, people will have more money in their hands. And let them then buy the best health and education that they choose to buy. They should not be dependent on the state. And growth will also serve another effect, which is to raise more revenues for the state. The state, through economic growth, will also have more money, which has been the case since the 1990s. The public spending has actually increased substantially, not in proportional terms, but in absolute terms in India. So growth would give government ever rising revenue. This would enhance public expenditures on health. So one is saying health and education first, then growth. Sustainable growth will result, in very simple terms. The other is saying invest in government. Concentrate on growth, health and education is important. The Amartya Sen does this Jagdish Bhagwati debate happen in the background of the discussion for what is called the Gujarat model? The Gujarat model, the model of development in this state over the last 12 years under the leadership of Narendra Modi, became an issue of great debate and discussion in the run-up to the elections, almost symbolizing, in a sense, this very, these two approaches to battling poverty and economic development. And in fact, as I said, Bhagwati and Arvind Panikkar were great supporters of Narendra Modi's leadership and approach to economic growth and development. Amartya Sen was deeply dismayed by what he saw happening in Gujarat, and that illustrated this. As I said, it's a clash of ideas, and we need to understand these two debates well and take positions on them, because it is one of the most important questions of our time. What I found interesting about the discussion, that there was an article I wrote about it as well, where I said that, you know, there, in India over the last couple of years, particularly in the run-up, as Narendra Modi was being projected as the finest administrator that this country has, it was interesting that there were two assessments of the same government. Normally, you know, you and I disagree about something, our disagreements would be, you know, I would give it, say, you'd give it 70%, I'd give it 50%, or, you know, that much difference is understandable. But here we had assessment where one set of people would give it 100 marks out of 100, one set of people would give it 0 or 10. So here you have 90 or 100 here, and 0 or 10 here, and this kind of the same government. And I found that interesting. It's interesting, it shows how deeply divided is our idea and imagination of a good government. So for one set of people, Narendra Modi's leadership here in this state represents the very best kind of governance that we can have. Whereas for another set of people, it is the most disastrous, deeply worrying. And there's a book, in fact, on my email today, I've seen that one more book has been written, but it's an important book by a feminist economist who's Gujarati, and called Indira Devve and Inchamisha. They put together a book which is on the Gujarat model. So this has become an interesting area for discussion. How are there two such diametrically opposed evaluations of the same government at this extreme? So there's one view which favors the Gujarat model, which says it was decisive, it was strong, it was, even if it was authoritarian, we need that kind of strong governance. We've had weak governance for too long. It created a hugely business-friendly environment. And it led to sustained economic growth. It is not, contrary to what we believe, it's not the highest growth state in the country. Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, and others have been. But it has sustained high economic growth. Actually, there was a particular moment when it almost became symbolic of his authoritative, efficient, business-friendly decision-making. When the Tatas, small car factory, and for the rest of you, the Tatas had invested in a small car factory in West Bengal. But it got caught up in huge battles and wrangles, led by, in fact, the person who went on to become the chief minister of the state, against the land acquisition, because it was double crop land which was being acquired. The government was just not able to deal with all of those agitations. The power plant was delayed for years. Things were really in a bad shape. Narendra Modi made an offer that you come here, within 1 month I will get you land. And he set up the factory, and it happened. And the factory started producing, and that in a sense symbolizes what a truly decisive, effective, business-friendly government is. But then, those of us who have worries and questions, one question we asked was, what were the terms on which Mr. Tata came here? And at one point, he, Mr. Tata said, you have to be a fool not to want to invest in Gujarat. And he was right. After, you know, people did, there was an RTI, right information investigation, and these are the terms. The total subsidies given by the Gujarat government to Tata Motors is more than $6 billion of public investment, 30,000 crore rupees. Tata invested 2,900 crores. So, say X amount is invested by Tata. The state gives you 3X amount. As a loan at 0.1% rate of interest, repayable after 20 years. Okay? Charges for transferring the land from agriculture to non-agricultural purposes, registration fees completely waived. The entire infrastructure cost, developing roads, electricity, gas supply, an additional 100 acres of land to build a township, all free. The cost of shifting the project to about 700 crores from West Bengal to Gujarat, 700 crores, all free, and so on and so forth. The Center for Science and Environment has calculated that 50% of the cost of the cheap car, 50% of the market price of the small car was public subsidy. So, you have to decide, we have to decide, is this what your imagination of a market-friendly government is? Should we be spending this scale of public money as benefits to private industry? Have the people of Gujarat gained benefits worthy of 30,000 crores, $6 billion of public money? Because there's that much of public money. So, as I'll show you in a later slide, the amount of Gujarat is one of the lowest spenders in health and education. Exactly those what was being debated. So, Gujarat went in for put all your money, the bulk of your money, on getting big industry here. And if it means you don't have any money left over for health and education, so be it. So, it's also, you know, Indira Hirbhe, I mentioned her, one of our country's best known feminist economists. She said that, you know, this, you know, in her commentary on this, she said that it turns on its head the very idea of taxation. So, here, instead, you know, we've always believed that taxation is meant to be, you tax from the rich to provide for the poor. Then you're taxing the poor to provide the super, super rich. Is that good government? Is something that we have to decide. The other part of the story, which is even more worrying, is what happens to human beings. So, Gujarat ranks 17 among the states in proportion of development expenditure. You know, so, the amount of money left for development expenditure was obviously much less. If this is where you're spending your money, then it's 17th among Indian states in a proportion of development. Only 1.09% of public expenditure in Gujarat was on education and health, well behind other states. I mean, Rajasthan, which is a much poorer state, in you know, in the neighborhood, we're spending three times almost this amount. Between 1999 and this period, fewer children between 6 and 14 attended school than in the national average. Within that, this debate has been very dramatic. You're sitting in Gujarat, it was actually a central question that went through the elections of the last year. Narendra Modi was elected as Prime Minister. So I think it's interesting to use this example to illustrate this debate. So the proportion of girls, Dalits, tribals, Muslims, minority children who attended school were much below the national average in Gujarat. Gujarat has, you know, infant mortality, under 5 mortality, mortality rate, all the main indices of human development. Gujarat actually fares pretty badly. The most important of all of these, IFPRI, which is an international agency, rated Gujarat and the hunger index. They have a hunger index which they calculate. Gujarat was rated as alarming. It was the lowest among the higher income states. And it was even below the states of Orissa, which is almost considered like the hunger center of the country, and Uttar Pradesh, which is notorious for probably the worst kind of governance that we have. So the choices and the contrasts are instructive and stark. So the Gujarat model offers you an extremely aggressively, effectively, decisively, industry-friendly environment where you make large public investments to attract and hold on to big industry. But you do very little for human development, you have very little public investment in healthcare, education, and you end up in a situation where infant mortality, child malnutrition, hunger, all of these are alarmingly high for high income, and even compared to low income states, it's very high. So that's the choice, and that is why I said it illustrates really this question about what is your imagination of a good girl. Some of you in this room, many of you in this room might say, might still agree with Bhagwati that this is a price we have to pay. Let industries operate, let wealth be produced, let jobs come. Ultimately, people will be better off. You don't want to have a government which spends and enters and builds schools and hospitals and provides cheap food and social protection, etc. You might still adhere to that, but you must understand what the story is about. Yeah? I want to just read out what somebody said, and I won't tell you who this person is. In far too many countries, the benefits of growth are being sustained by far too few people. This is not a recipe for stability and sustainability. Let me be frank. In the past, economists have underestimated the importance of inequality. They have focused on economic growth, on the size of the pie, rather than its distribution. Today, we are more keenly aware of the damage done by inequality. Put simply, a severely skewed income distribution harms the pace and the sustainability of growth over the longer term. It leads to an economy of exclusion and a wasteland of discarded potential. Who do you think said this? Not Thomas Piketty, no. Not much the same either. It's interesting that these are the words of the IMF president. The MD of the IMF, Christine Lagarde. This is a recent speech made. And it just reflects that there is, as I was saying yesterday, inequality has nudged its way back increasingly to the center stage of the discourse. People are recognizing that we can't go on like this. Even people deeply committed to that growth model. She continues, in the US, inequality is back to where it was before the Great Depression. And the richest 1% have captured 95% of all income gains since 2009, while the bottom 90% got poorer. In India, the net worth of the billionaire community has increased 12-fold in 15 years. Just this increase is enough to eliminate absolute poverty in the country twice over. A large amount of work done by women is not priced. It's unpaid, it's unrecognized. So I would say economic growth is equal to the higher production of priced goods and services in an economy. So what we are basically saying is that the more that you have of production, how much is produced, is the basic core factor which determines how well off, how healthy that economy is, and how healthy that society is. That's what we're saying, that economic growth is something that we should aspire to. In simple terms, does everybody understand? My point, when I think about it, is that there are at least three other questions that I would like to ask before I decide how healthy my economy is. I would ask how much of goods and services. But there are three other questions. The first is, what goods and services? So are we producing luxury goods when people, don't have food and clean water, for instance? Are we, producing armaments, or are we producing basic needs of the poor, etc., etc.? So, first, in addition to how much you have to ask, what is being produced? The second is, for whom is it being produced? What is the distribution of the goods and services? Yeah. And third, by what means is this being produced? Are you producing in ways that are displacing labor, displacing people from their lands, destroying forests, destroying the environment, poisoning rivers, poisoning the air? All of these are relevant questions. So our imagination of the health of an economy for too long has been measured only around the one question of how much. Not questions of what, for whom, and by what. Conventionally, we see a dichotomy posed between, do you believe in growth or do you believe in equity? My fundamental point is, I think that this is a false dichotomy. I don't believe that we really have a choice between one or the other. This is my conviction. My conviction is that India's economic growth is built on two unequal foundations. If you look at the countries which have done the best in sustaining high levels of economic growth for long periods, they built it on a foundation where they have ensured good quality education for all, healthcare, land reforms, a few basic things which allow the participation of large populations in that whole economic growth. I think that without greater equity, growth is not going to be sustainable. And that's something that I would be arguing through, but that's the point that I want to leave. And I wanted to say that my conviction is about the good state. The good state is not just that one that works for markets. It does have to work for markets, but also one which redistributes and invests for education, healthcare, nutrition, social protection for people with disabilities. And Mahatma Gandhi used to talk about a government which wipes every tear from every eye. And in the truest sense, that is the means relevant to me as the ideal state.